This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Today on Dreamland, we have a very special guest, John Ramirez. John has been an intelligence officer for many years. He is recently retired from that work and is here to discuss a number of his most extraordinary findings, and also to talk about how the UFO community can address the intelligence community usefully, rather than just sending blanket FOIA requests to the CIA. There's much more that can be done. John has received permission to talk about everything that he is going to talk about today. John is not a whistleblower, and which, as you will hear later, makes this all the more extraordinary. John, welcome to Dreamland, and I would like to start, if I can, by asking you to tell us about your own background and what you did in the intelligence community.
Well, Whitley, thank you for having me. My name again is John Ramirez. I was a GS-15 officer of the Central Intelligence Agency. I had a 25 career with the Central Intelligence Agency that also included a stint with the Office of the Director of National Intelligence. I was assigned to the Director of Science and Technology originally when I started my career in the field known as Technical Electronic Intelligence. You'll hear the term TEC-ELINT refer to this type of discipline. It's a subdiscipline of signals intelligence, SIGINT. And I also served as an intelligence officer of Finnish intelligence for the Director of Intelligence. And by Finnish intelligence, I mean it's all source intelligence that has been coordinated by the entire intelligence community. And the customers are policymakers, whether it be a cabinet officer or the President of the United States. We deliver a variety of products to these policymakers. And I finished my career in the field of counterproliferation in the National Counterproliferation Center, where I was exposed to the greater picture of the entire intelligence community, including budgets, including what I call white budgets, dark budgets, and mostly many, many shades of gray in between those two extremes. So that's a little bit about myself, Whitley. Then we can talk about many of the things. It's not really a revelation of the things we're talking about. It's basically me putting together some history using historiographic analysis, which you look at where we are today and you look at what history you can discover from the past and you draw the dots as to how we got here from where we were. And so that was the intent of this presentation. CIA approved it saying that it was unclassified. There's nothing in there that's actually classified. I try my best to throw in things that I thought would be redacted, and it didn't get redacted, and I was very surprised. And as a jumping off point, when it went to CIA, I believe it went higher than CIA. It went to the folks in government who actually are working to manage this entire UFO, UAP, ET issue, which they lump together in one word. It's called the phenomenon with a capital P. And from there, we can probably have our discussion right now, Whitley, on these things.
Okay. Before we get into the phenomenon itself, I think one of the most important parts of the deck that you sent me in, John has created a 74-page deck of slides, basically, and we'll be showing some of them over the course of the show. The first group of them outline the structure of the intelligence community and offer a roadmap to the UFO community as to who to ask which questions. Now, John, there have not been many really well-targeted FOIA requests. And what surprises me is that even the people who are supposed to be knowledgeable about this actually are concentrating their FOIA requests on the CIA. What's a better way to do it?
Well, I think a better way to do it is to look at the phenomenon in its entirety. And there could be many aspects to the phenomenon. There's a visual, of course. People see things, orbs or craft or even beings. The second part is that there might be some emanations coming from the phenomenon that we could detect, either on the ground or in space. As you know, the SIGINT system is wide-ranging, especially in the Five Eyes country. And also, most of the world is covered by our SIGINT system. And so if there's any kind of phenomenon involving an orb, there might be some emanations that NSA might have collected and analyzed. And then there's the, I call the other aspects that are hard to describe. And these are like radiological or the things that can't be seen. And they can include aural, spectral, those type of phenomena should also be looked at. And then finally, just plain imagery. Did we take pictures of it from space? Did we see it coming in from space? So different intelligence agencies are responsible for each of those. For example, under human intelligence, we have CIA. So that's talking to or finding information from either foreign governments or from just eyewitnesses. Open source intelligence is the most obvious one, and that's what most people do in ufology. That is to look at original documents, look at television programs, look at media, mass media, to garner any kind of information about the phenomenon that was witnessed. So I use the crop circle as an example of, there are people that may have seen it, and so you might want to talk to them. Open sources under CIA, although many other agencies also practice open source, there's a little bit of cross disciplining in the intelligence community. For example, I mentioned measurement and signature intelligence, geospatial. I think they covered all of them. So if you look at which agency does what, for let's say a crop circle, CIA would want eyewitness accounts. CIA would want to know if anything has been written about it. NSA would want to maybe collect electromagnetic data. And DIA might want to collect any kind of spectral, even aural, sound, sonic, radiological, biochemical. And NGA finally might want to, might have overhead intelligence, overhead imagery about that being created.
So it would be a matter of determining what kind of signals or images that might be associated with a given object. I'll give you an example of this. I have a video of an object, excuse me, that shows what looked like distortions in the atmosphere immediately around it. And I've had that looked at by engineers and physicists, and the consensus is that the object is has an extremely powerful magnetic field around it that is emanating a kind of electromagnetic plasma. What agency would I ask about the detection of something like this? Because certainly the right instruments would detect it.
Exactly the point that from a photograph, it's like telling me I took a picture of a radio tower and I know from the picture that it operates at a certain FM frequency. What you describe of these scientists and engineers looking at a photograph and looking at...
Well, it was a video.
A video and looking at wave disturbance is exactly like that. It's not scientific data. It's a subjective interpretation of what might have caused that type of wave interference. So with energy, if we assume that the wave interference was caused by some displacement of energy or some creation of energy...
That there would have been something detectable. Obviously, it's not detectable in the video,
right.
But there was some kind of an emanation that was powerful enough to disturb disturb the video. Therefore, something else might have been able to detect it and might have done so.
Right, and that would fall under measurement and signature intelligence, or MASINT, which is the DIA's bailiwick. So DIA would be the most obvious. Secondly, NGA, the National Geospatial Intelligence Agency, collecting imagery intelligence, they would actually might be able to see it, because there are sensors that can detect those type of interferences in the atmosphere, aerospace, and in space. So those, what we call hyperspectral MASINT sensors, or MASINT sensors, should be able to at least discern some type of energy coming from that type of interference.
So we would have a situation where, if we went to these agencies, would we have to identify specific incidents, or would we simply ask for how would we approach them?
Well, the way intelligence is collected, it's everything is date time stamped based on Greenwich Mean Time, and so it's important to know when and where that phenomenon occurred. And so you would need to at least narrow it down to where they can actually look and find the data. The intelligence community, on a daily basis, on an hourly basis, collects so much data. And to wade through it all, it would require these intelligence agencies to at least get some idea of when that phenomenon occurred, and then they can narrow down on what sensors may have been in that time frame, and then location, what sensors made up what pass on over the Earth, over that exact point on the Earth. So it would help them a lot. Otherwise, asking for a vacuum cleaner approach, just so-called hoovering the data, is very ineffective. So it would be very important to, get at least some knowledge of when and where it occurred, and then levy the FOIA against what you're looking for. I would say MASINT for DIA, in this occasion, GEOINT for NGA.
Now, one of the reasons I ask is that we have those videos from the U.S. Navy, and we know the precise time and place that the videos were made, and therefore we know the objects were present there. And I am thinking to myself that other agencies, not the U.S. Defense Department and the U.S. Navy, but some of the intelligence agencies might have picked up information of some kind involving those incidents at the same time. In other words, could the NGA have picked up anything optically, or the DIA the NSA, any kind of electromagnetic data? In other words, we could ask about those particular periods and see what we get.
That's exactly right, Whitley. That's the way to go about it. So I don't know if any of our national sensors picked up anything. The national sensors work against what's known as a collection deck. These are taskings to the sensors based on where the sensor is at the moment, the time, date, and even what orbit is it on, to see what that sensor can collect. So I wouldn't know if our sensors would collect against a routine Navy exercise at sea. It's not something that we would collect. But saying that, it's certainly worth it to see if they could see the actual energy, or even optically, if they can actually see the object from whence it came and where it went. So that's very important to to narrow it down just by that, and then to leverage, what are you looking for? You know it existed already, so you actually have from the FA-18 AFLR footage, you know what time, you know where, you know a lot of things about it. But that's just from a tactical sensor. The FA-18 sensor, IR sensor, was not designed to collect scientific level data. It's basically designed to find a heat signature in order to target a missile. So it's not going to find, you know, what was that energy composed of. But the national sensors might be able to do that. And so I would go to those two agencies, DIA and NGA, and I don't believe anyone has yet. It's only gone to the Pentagon, or whatever the Pentagon is willing to release. Secondly, the USS Princeton CG-59, the Aegis the cruiser, has on board a device called the SLIC, or SLQ, SLIC 32, and that is the countermeasures set on board the ship, and that has an ability to collect microwave signatures, microwave signals. And I'm not sure if the sailors, the cryptologic technicians operating the SLIC 32, might have collected and recorded data of emanations coming from the craft, the Tic Tac craft. So that's another avenue, and that goes to the Office of Naval Intelligence and also the Office of Naval Research. And there are specific places in the Office of Naval Research where data goes to of that type. And so by going to that particular office, if you know what it is, would help. And I had it written down somewhere. I was in contact with Gary Vuris of the Princeton. He was a fire control technician. And I levied some questions I myself had. And one of the questions I asked, which I had no response yet, was about that SLIC 32. So sure, we have a lot of the aircraft video from the Super Hornets, but how about any kind of electromagnetic emanations? How about what we know we call radar intelligence? That's just the signal returns from the SPY-1 radar and the SPS-49 air search radar, which were operating at the time. And that could provide valuable information as well as to what the signature return on radar might have looked like. And that also goes to the Office of Naval Research and Office of Naval Intelligence. So it's all they released now was just that AFLR video. But I think there's a lot of data out there that needs to be tapped and waiting to be tapped, not just on this particular case, but also on many others that have been collected recently.
Well, yeah, there must be a lot, because I think we've been taking imagery almost, well, at least since the late 1940s. Free Dreamlanders, I've got good news and bad news. The bad news is it's time for a break. The good news is this is all worth doing, so definitely do what we ask you to in these commercials. We'll be right back.
Support unknowncountry.com and its great mission to make contact happen. Use our vast archive of interviews, meditations, commentaries, news, and Whitley Strieber audiobooks to expand your mind and your understanding of close encounter. Meet others who have similar interests on our active free message board or in our subscriber comments and Wednesday night chats. There is no other site like Unknown Country in or out of this world. Go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today.
How curious are you? How much do you really want to know about the world you live in? There are, for example, very real conspiracies. We're talking about one of them today. And this is a place where if it's real, we're going to talk about it, but not if it's not real. So there's no confusion here. If we're talking conspiracy on Dreamland and on unknowncountry.com, it's because we can prove it, just like we can prove that the Roswell incident has been covered up. We can prove these things. We can prove that the abduction phenomena is in some way very real. We can prove that there are unusual materials in this world because some of them are right here in my possession. So, this is an unusual place. It's a unique place. And above all, it is a great place to explore. Exploring the unknowncountry.com archive is a really extraordinary experience. It's a place where you can regain what we are losing, which is a lost sense of wonder and a willingness to explore the unknown. We live in a terribly difficult world right now. This place is an oasis of wonder. Join unknowncountry.com today. We're talking to John Ramirez. John has a long history of involvement. He is a career intelligence officer, and he has recently retired and is gotten permission to discuss in depth a number of different things with us, among them how to actually approach the intelligence community with freedom of information requests, which we have been discussing. Now, I want to go on now into the area of commercial imagery, because there is a very large support community in the defense industry that supports the intelligence community, and with different types of electronic and other support. Is there any way to approach these companies, or are they simply legally protected from any such approach?
They're commercial companies, and so they're out there with a business model to make money. In fact, for commercial imagery sources, it might be little known that the company Digital Globe and its predecessor company were founded by imagery analysts from the National Photographic Interpretation Center, the part of CIA that actually looked at images collected by satellites, the early satellites. They were located in Building 213, what we call Building 213 in Washington, D.C., which is now part of the Washington Nationals baseball stadium. So right, it's in a corner of that where the imagery was analyzed that led to the discovery of Russian missiles on Cuban soil back in the early 60s. So that needed to be spun off in order to create commercial imagery, because there was a demand for it. And there's such a demand for it that the intelligence community not just collected imagery for intelligence use, but they also covered like natural disasters. For example, if there's a flood or something and we needed overhead imagery of it. Of course, we have NOAA to just look at huge cloud formations, but our satellites are able to look more in depth at close-up imagery to see the type of damage that may have occurred. So there's so much demand for it that it was spun off as a business area, totally separate from the intelligence community, but it used technology from the National Reconnaissance Office. The first few satellites were NRO satellites that were older generation and were provided to Digital Globe for launching into space. So Google Earth, for example, Google does not own any satellites. All of those satellites are Digital Globe, or now Maxar technology satellites. And there's a constellation of there were there were five satellites, but one failed. And there's an interesting story about that. The four satellites that are up are varying capability, but the best ones, WorldView 3, is remarkable. The government allows this commercial enterprise to take pictures from space about 380 miles up. And if you have a piece of cardboard lying flat on the ground, and you have several pieces of cardboard, and you decide to put an eye doctor chart on it of various letters of the alphabet, and that satellite from 380 miles can actually read a cardboard the size of 10 by 10 inches, let's say. And 10 by 10 inches is a very good resolution. But what we see on Google Maps and Google Earth is the worst way to do any kind of research into crop circles or any kind of other phenomenon, because you only get a snapshot of time. That's all Google can buy, is a snapshot of time. The intelligence community, however, can purchase 24/7 on-demand products to the tune of $300 million. So commercial imagery is important, but in order to get useful imagery, you need to buy a product from this company, Maxar Technologies, for several hundred million dollars so that you can get on their tool and then pull up any imagery anywhere you want in the world moments after it was processed by the ground station in Colorado. So that's very impressive, but that's also very expensive.
Yeah, I should say so. It's a little beyond my own budget. Let me ask you this. There has been an enormous amount of controversy, of course, about crop formations, and you specifically mentioned in one of your pieces in the deck about the Euler's identity crop circle in Wiltshire in England in June 21st, 2010. And you asked the question, and I'm asking you, what disciplines would be involved in investigating a crop circle? Because I think it's possible that there could be imagery somewhere that shows them being formed, and that would maybe close the question about whether or not they're all fakes.
I would say, again, I don't know if any of our satellites are tasked to cover fields in our ally, the UK. That's not something we would do. So that's point number one. Point number two is, right now, I don't know that crop circles are actually part of the collection deck. I don't know if there's a demand for it now, today. However, I was interested in the fact that the National Geospatial Intelligence Agency, again, this is the agency that collects and analyzes imagery intelligence, held a competition in November of 2020 to help the agency find a good algorithm to find circles on the ground. I was surprised with NGA's talent pool of scientists and engineers that they will hold a competition, but they did. They asked for help from the public, and it was awarded earlier this year on January 6, 2021, an algorithm to find circles. So why is that so tough? Well, a lot of the imagery collected is mostly buildings and things like missiles on the ground or like facilities. It's a multidimensional object. And here from space, a crop circle is basically flat. And it's hard for a satellite to detect these types of images. If it was a raised image like a gas tank or something that you will see on the side of the road, fields and fields of tanks full of some type of liquid, that would be easier to collect, but not a flat image. And to actually have them collect a circle being made, it would have to be tasked to do that. And that's like 24/7 coverage over a country which we don't really cover. So I don't know how we could leverage NGA directly. But since there's such a push to cover the entire phenomenon in its entirety, through Congress even, through a recent legislation of the National Defense Authorization Act of fiscal year 2022, It does make it formal to have all of the phenomenon analyzed by a central office in the Pentagon and have a report to Congress, to the policymakers every 180 days. So as part of that, it may provide a way for the intelligence community itself to task itself in finding every aspect of the phenomenon, which could include crop circles. But I would think it would be worth asking NGA if they have any crop circles, just so they would see that it's an avenue that they should explore themselves, that they would write the requirements to do something like that. I think it's far-fetched, but it's worth a try.
Worth a try. Because I think that it, especially when the phenomenon began, there was a lot of interest in it, and I would publicly, and I would think that because it was, its origins were clearly mysterious, there would have been interest in it at the intelligence level also. But I believe that might have been primarily British, British intelligence sources rather than ours. I don't know. Now, what about another thing that always troubles me? There are at least a couple dozen people out there in this world who call themselves whistleblowers and who claim to be revealing top secret information to the public. And they claim that they're not being prosecuted because if they were prosecuted, then it would reveal that there was something valid about their information. And I've often wondered about this because I grew up in a family that was associated with mostly military intelligence rather than and FBI related stuff, rather than this part of the intelligence community. But it was, secrets were very serious business. And we children, when we even accidentally heard something, we were taken aside and warned very sternly never to speak of anything that we heard. I once heard my father and brother talking downstairs when I was upstairs, and my father realized I had overheard them. It had nothing to do with UFOs, by the way. It was a completely different subject. And I was told at the age of 9 never to speak of it because it was illegal to do so. So what is this about? Are these people for real, do you think? Or do you have any way of assessing that?
Well, first of all, I would find out as much to the extent possible something about their background to validate their background. For example, a CIA officer, I'm an agent for the CIA, and I have cosmic top secret intelligence about UFOs, and I was cleared above top secret. Right there are several red flags for me. First of all, a CIA officer would never call himself or herself an agent of the CIA. An agent of the major intelligence agencies, especially CIA and DIA, both agencies are case handlers of foreign agents. An agent is a foreign national who, in exchange for his access or her access to their highest levels of government, agree to spy against their government in exchange for monetary compensation, goods and services. So basically in police work, they're known as compensated informants. That's basically what they are. So no self-respecting intelligence officer of the intelligence community will call himself or herself an agent. Cosmic is a type of communications classification protocol to indicate indications and warning of an imminent, for example, Soviet attack. It's used within NATO only. So it doesn't take an experienced imagery or intelligence analyst to determine that if you have, for example, a movement of Russian leadership to the Ural Mountains, and you can detect that, and say, okay, the leadership moved to a safe protection area. And you notice that the Russian strategic forces, their missiles are fueling up or preparing to launch because there are signals associated with checking out these missiles, let's say, and we're able to collect it. That would be an indication that might give warning of something happening, and especially if on the border with its former East European allies on the Russian side of the border, there was an amassing of like Russian armor. All of that would be indications of warning of imminent attack. And that type of warning would go out through what's known as cosmic channels to NATO. Now, what channel would the president use? In fact, I can reveal the channel based on open source. There was a program on one of the streaming channels called Pine Gap. The first, I would say, 20 minutes of Pine Gap used to reveal what was top secret Biman information about the overhead constellation. And there it was, including where the major facilities are located, as well as where they're at, and also the idea that that we're all talking to each other as one big intelligence community collection or architecture, and a depiction of what they claim is a satellite. And within it, they had an incident which they had to report to the president. And so the within the show, they used something called the Critic channel, C-R-I-T-I-C, Critic. And that yes. show pretty much got it right. So a critic type of communication will go straight to the president as very urgent. And so those are the types of channels reporting to the highest leadership in the country of anything urgent like that.
I see. So I will always have a level of suspicion about these whistleblowers, frankly. I just can't imagine doing that. I've known too many people in this community, and the ones who really are engaged in it professionally, I just don't see them as coming out and saying all the kinds of things that people have said. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. But what is here or there is that John has some fascinating observations on the UAP Task Force preliminary assessment and Free Dreamlanders. As soon as we pause for some commercials, we will be talking about that. Subscribers, we will keep right on keeping on. We'll be right back. There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is, if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is, can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is. And it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle. We're talking to John Ramirez. John is has been in the intelligence community for his entire career, is now retired, and is taking an interest in helping to regularize and raise the level of professionalism of the UFO community's interface with intelligence community, and how the UFO community can obtain more accurate information by asking the right questions to the right agencies in the right way. Now, John, I'd like to go on at this point two things. One is the observations on the UAP Task Force preliminary assessment, which I find your observations were you call them reading between the lines from the personal best guesses of a former weapons intelligence analyst. Now, let's talk about the tactical sensors. Well, let me just let you talk about it rather than trying to coordinate it with the deck, the card in the deck.
Well, we discussed this already, Whitley, in the brief, that the sensors on a fighter plane, such as the F/A-18 Super Hornet, were designed to detect, acquire, track, and engage targets. It was not designed to collect scientific data. So the sensors on board the Super Hornets engaging with Tic Tac were not able to produce the type of infrared data that can be analyzed to the depth that would indicate any kind of understanding of what kind of energy that might have been. It's just looking for a bright object to shoot at. And so the Tic Tac presented a bright object. And so that sensor did exactly what it was supposed to do, just keep it in lock to the extent possible. And so you saw in the video, the engagement area right in the middle of that display, always trying to keep lock on the craft. So it did that very well, but it's just a big bright blob. And it went to a positive image so you can see it. And then it went back to the IR image, which is just a big white blob. And that's not very useful.
No.
Secondly, so there needs to be, if the military would want to, the military would need to request the development and the deployment of more advanced sensors if they expect our aircraft to be able to detect and then have some data to analyze post-detection, post-encounter. The national sensors are capable of doing exactly that, of being able to produce intelligence quality data that can be analyzed on a scientific type of basis. But it's revealing that the UAPs took an interest in our sensors that we fly in space. And so, again, talking about FOIA, who controls this? Who flies the craft? NRO flies the craft. Who analyzes the data? The NGA analyzes the data. So if it's a SIGINT satellite, a signals intelligence gathering satellite in orbit, then who would have data about any emanations of a UAP craft interested in that satellite? That would be NSA. So there's probably a treasure trove of data, if it's true, and I believe it's true, that these sensors were examined by these UAP craft. That's an avenue for FOIA. There's also another craft called the X-37B, which is an extremely sensitive craft in the intelligence community. It is a type of advanced sensor, and I would just leave it at that. And exactly what it does, I believe I was not clear for. I'm just quoting open source on this X-37B craft. That's with U.S. Space Force. There's another way to leverage FOIA requests for this type of data with U.S. Space Force. Were the UAPs interested in XB-37 craft specifically? ask that specific question at any time during, and then you can find out when the X-37B was in flight. Lastly, and it was quite obvious that the sensors were not present, or inadequate sensors were present at some of the facilities UAPs were interested in, and that could be military facilities or our nuclear production facilities, things of that sort, even NASA facilities. They're not looking up for something like that. In the military facilities, you would assume would have radar. But that's radar. Is there any instrument grade optical collection? And apparently there was not an adequate level of collection. And then, looking at all of this data, there needs to be a place within the intelligence community or Defense Department that collates all of this data officially as their number one 24/7 job. And there isn't at this point. There are no national intelligence officers to write national intelligence estimates about these UAPs. And there are no on the ground rank and file analysts who are analyzing UAPs with the intent of informing policymakers of recent encounters or recent intelligence collected from the UAPs. So all of these things need to be addressed. And I would say for the last one, an office, if the National Defense Authorization Act for FY 2022 goes through unscathed, there might be an office within the next fiscal year set up to look at UAPs 24/7, not a task force that's temporary, but an office that will fall under the oversight of Congress and will be required by Congress to produce formal reports twice a year. So there's some good news on the horizon if all of these things follow through.
Yes, and I've been inquiring of some congressmen on both sides of the aisle about this, and there doesn't seem to be any real opposition to leaving this in the act, so in the bill. So it looks like it'll go through, and the appropriations bill is going to pass almost certainly. Now, let's go to, let me see where we are on time, just a minute.
This is Whitley Strieber. Listen to me now. From June of 2010, talking to Alan Lammers about an incredible thing that happened to him on the island of Sulawesi in Indonesia.
Here you are in South Sulawesi in the little town in the district of Sandu Batu. What happened? You were told something rather strange.
Well, we were told before we went, my friends that I worked with with the NGO, they told me that when you pack, because it kind of happened by accident, I went out to buy a raincoat. It rains quite a bit in this part of the world. And so I went out and I bought a yellow raincoat. And my friend said, "I'm sorry, you can't take that to Walla Walla." And I said, "Well, why not?" And he says, "Well, you can't wear that color." So anyways, excuse me. So I thought, okay, well, what colors can I wear? They said, well, you can only wear black or white. You cannot wear any bright colors, no bright green, especially no yellow. And, you know, that's all you should bring. And I said, well, what would happen? And they said, well, people disappear.
You will find the rest of that story, and it is brain-bending, in the June 5th edition of Dreamland, June 5, 2010 edition of Dreamland in the unknowncountry.com archive. This archive is one of the richest of its kind in the world, probably is the richest of its kind in the world, filled with extraordinary shows, of which this show is certainly one, this show with Alan Lammers. You will never have heard anything like it. It does what Dreamland is here to do. It opens your mind to the fact that we live inside a hidden reality that we prefer not to acknowledge, but not here. Here on unknowncountry.com, we do acknowledge it. We live in it and we love it. Subscribe today. You can't go wrong. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and get started.
I'm having a little, okay. We're going to take another brief break for our free Dreamlanders. Enjoy the commercials and reflect as you do so on the importance of this show and this website. There's nothing like it in the world. It's unique. We'll be right back. We're talking to John Ramirez, who has spent his career in intelligence work and has now retired and has received permission from his agencies to discuss the things that we are discussing today. John is not a whistleblower, but he is highly knowledgeable, and he is offering a lot of useful ways in to understanding and how to and executing inquiries of the intelligence community that will actually work to bring about some more useful FOIA responses than we have obtained in the past. Now, I would like to turn to your hypothetical case study of a UAP event. Specifically, this is the Tether incident of February the 25th, 1996, where an unusual phenomenon occurred. Can you describe what it was and then go into how the intelligence community today would respond to this?
I should preface my remarks by saying that the STS-75 Tether incident wasn't what I was describing as a hypothetical case. I just used that as an illustration.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Of what a hypothetical case might look like. So I don't have pictures of orbs, but that was the closest I could find an open source that I can present in the slide. So let's say that the imagery sensor with its hyperspectral payload was able to detect a orb or orbs flying in formation. And it seemed to be flying under intelligent control with a purpose in mind, an intent to go to a certain destination. And if it is detected in that imagery, the first thing that is going to happen is to rule out the obvious. So you would rule out that it is Soviet or Chinese or some other craft from another country flying in that manner. So, for example, if an orb was detected emitting some kind of energy field, we would look at what is in the inventory overseas that could generate that type of energy field. So it could be, for example, I'll give you two. The Sukhoi Su-34 fullback, which is a strategic bomber in a way. It had a plasma stealth generator. The plasma stealth generator is openly discussed in the Russian literature that they had something like this. And the other craft would be like the MiG-31, the MiG-31 Foxhound, which still to this day has the altitude record for an air-breathing craft of 123,000 feet. And it usually flies like 85 to 100,000 feet in combat mode. It was designed to shoot down the SR-71. By flying as high as it could with the SR-71 and actually shooting downward with its missiles from a look-down perspective. And so that the existence of the MiG-31 and its capabilities pretty much retired the SR-71, along with advances in Russian aerospace. So we would look at those. Could it be those? No, it wasn't anything like an aircraft of that nature. Okay, something might be wrong with the software on the ground. No, the software checks out. The third one to check would be, is the satellites themselves, are they malfunctioning? And NGA would say, no, they're not. They're working fine. So now we need to inform someone, the Director of National Intelligence, for example. And the Director of National Intelligence authorizes a community working group to look into this with a deep dive of pulling together all of the resources within the intelligence community. And there are 18 agencies. So they would pull together like CIA, NSA, DIA, the Department of Energy, National Labs. NGA, of course, is a sponsoring organization as well as the NRO. And they would meet together along with contractors and brief these people into what was detected. Each agency will brief its own subject matter experts to examine this. And through more study of these experts and more collection being tasked, the objective is to reach a consensus and write a report for the DNI. Let's say that report gets written. The DNI would then brief the President of the United States and offer decision levers. The intelligence community never makes policy, but it does offer a range of decisions the policymakers can take. We call them decision levers because they're cast in a way that they can pull this one lever and then see what might result theoretically. So we do that study for them. So decision lever one might be to observe the phenomenon, but continue active data collection and analysis. Nothing very kinetic at this point, just more passive. Decision lever two might be to engage the phenomena, but do not threaten it. That is to attract the phenomena. And decision lever three might be to engage the phenomena, but do it and to evoke a reaction. And that does imply a kinetic type of policy to engage it in that sense. I believe that taking it to the current UAP revelations, that we are in a decision level two, that is to engage the phenomenon, but do not threaten it. In the NDAA legislative language, there is a part of it that asks the Defense Department to report on activities related to capturing one of these craft, capturing. And so that implies decision level three of engaging the phenomenon, but to provoke a reaction. Capturing is very kinetic. And I fear that the Defense Department, when they see that word capture something, they would interpret it as let's shoot it down. And so I think that has some ramifications that are serious. And I hope that that's not what Congress intended when they wrote that language into that legislation. But what I describe, I would say, is something that would have led to something like ALSAP and ATIP. These are like what I call Title 50 U.S. Code type of meetings. It's the civilian side of the intelligence community, which is driven by science and technology, not by any type of weapons acquisition or weapons threat assessment. We just want to know what it is. And so that study might have concluded. And then on the Title 10 Department of Defense side, Title 10 U.S. Code is all about the Department of Defense. They took it from there and then cast it in the form of a threat scenario. Like, is this a threat? What is it exactly? Is it a foreign threat? So I believe that what I described actually led to a few years later to the creation of ALSAP and ATIP following it.
So we end up in a situation where there is a, you know, it occurs to me that a lot of the data that's being gathered may not even be really classified. Would it always be classified if an unknown object was detected or something in some way? If it was as long as it was unknown, or would it? Could it just be at a lower level, or maybe no level of classification at all, but simply not rising up to the level of public visibility in the system?
For the intelligence community, the data will always be classified. Will always be classified because releasing the data as it was collected in that level of detail will inform adversaries of how well we can do this collection against them, and may then result in countermeasures negating that collection. So we protect sources and methods, but the data itself, if it's then placed in a way that protects how well we collected the data. And I'm mincing words, I understand, but it's a very sensitive topic. But for example, I would use an example. That would be the best. There are occasions when the government releases imagery of events that may have happened. For example, let's say in Iran, that a rocket facility of some sort was destroyed. And I believe it was President Trump that revealed that imagery. The president, by virtue of the fact that he has original classification authority, can, with a stroke of a pen, take something top secret, compartment it, and make it completely unclassified. This has happened before in history when Jimmy Carter made a speech revealing the existence of photo reconnaissance satellites, which at that time was top secret within the NRO. That was the first time that slowly the intelligence community let loose of a lot of the data it had. And that was at the time when the church and Pike committees were in operation examining the behavior of the CIA during the Cold War. So there was an atmosphere of releasing information. Now that we have UAPs as a part of U.S. law, there could be, when that legislation gets passed, there could be an avenue where the Department of Defense can then release what might be considered classified to the public. And certainly that happened with the Antler videos that these planes shot, something that may have been classified and then released. So the actual release of data could happen, but I think it's going to be on a case-by-case basis. And it depends on what sensor collected it. If it's a sensitive sensor that the U.S. government does not acknowledge the existence of, then I would say that would be very, very slight chance. But we have Google Earth to look at, and then we have the Maxar satellites to examine data. I mean, I would say there's a possibility in the future that there will be a release of that type of information into the public domain. They will allow companies like Google to buy that data to have, and to, as the government, as these commercial capabilities come online, and they're much better than what's flying today, the commercial satellites being unclassified can certainly be an avenue of getting almost as good as NRO data. So, yes, I think there's an avenue for that to actually have this data unclassified.
Well, that's actually incredibly exciting. You speak in your quiet way, but you're saying extraordinary things and very hopeful things. Free Dreamlanders, it's time for us to say goodbye. And subscribers, in a few moments, we're going to get more deeply into this material, and I'm going to ask John about some information about some unusual events in Russia, and then we're going to perhaps move on, and if we run out of time, We'll have John back soon because there's a great deal more to discuss. Free Dreamlanders, thank you for being with us on Dreamland.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.